welcome Mark Russinovich and Scott Hanselman.
Mark was like, we're going to run out on stage. And I was like, we're not known for our athleticism.
And I gave him a stare.
And I said, all right, I'm not known for my athleticism. Whew. It's Mark and Scott Learn to Code. How are you?
Good. How are you?
I'm winded now because I just ran 13.
Sorry feet. About that.
All right. Y'all having fun at Build?
Yeah.
All right. Y'all want to see some code?
Yeah.
All right. Let's see some code. So here's the deal. We wanted to write something for real from scratch. There's all kinds of things where you can generate code, and we could generate some code, and you go, eh, look, we generate some code.
Yeah.
We wanted to make it hard.
Yep.
So I did a little bit of homework. I'm going to work on the back end of a multiplayer Asteroids game, doing the back end in SignalR and C#. I kind of laid out some functions, but I didn't really write much. And then Mark has hopefully been working for a couple of weeks on JavaScript, graphics, on the front end, and the Canvas work. And then we're going to connect them.
Yep.
Did you do the homework? Did you have someone do the homework?
I was supposed to do that already.
Yeah, homework. You do it at home. All right. So now Mark is going to use ChatGPT to do his homework.
Actually, I realized this morning that you did mean
okay.
before. So
yes, sir.
I started.
Okay, good. Well, show us what you got. Something.
Well, I did use ChatGPT.
Something basic, at least, hopefully, has been accomplished.
But it didn't do a very good job. So let me give it one more try. And I've been working on my prompt here.
That was your accomplishment.
Yeah.
Yeah. You have a notepad. Go ahead and copy paste that over there, brother.
Well, this version, I'll show you in a second, doesn't really do what I want it to.
Okay, so you're going to add a little value.
Yeah, sure. To include
so adorable ships, to watch managers type
asteroids and make them a different color than the back.
You have to tell it to make it a different color than the back. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
The whole asteroids in a snowstorm in white.
Yeah, so let's try
before.
That. Well, I'll show you what it did.
Okay, let's take a look.
Okay, while it's doing that, let me flip over. This is the first try.
Okay. Does it have any console errors, though?
No.
It does compile. It works.
I think it works.
Okay, it's working right now.
Second try. So it's got a ship.
It's good. It's a bit aimless, but I
figured you wouldn't think that's good enough, though.
No.
So here's the third try.
Well, it's good to know that I still have a job.
It's still generating.
Okay, so here is ChatGPT-4, and this is generating your homework for you on the front end. But we're doing a multiplayer game, so we're not going to be able to just ship this, you know.
But we can start with this, right?
Okay, let's start with this. So there we go. Let's bring that in, and let's see if it got it right. The fun part is it's like watching your dad use the mouse.
What? It's somebody else's keyboard. I'm nuts.
I can't find the Bing.
Thanks, Scott.
What's really happening is I've sabotaged Mark by giving him a vertical mouse.
Yeah.
So when this whole thing happens at the end, he's going to be like, that wasn't my mouse. I'm not familiar with that mouse.
You know what? Yeah,
you got to hit F2 to...
Here, you do it.
Yeah, I'm going to go ahead and do that for you.
I did all that hard work with the prompt.
I'm going to do it with sound effects.
Yeah. All right. What? It's the same thing
again.
As last time.
Okay.
Are you sure?
Yep. That one's dark blue.
Oh, nice.
That one's light blue.
All right. Okay. All right. So
kudos.
No. Yeah. All right. I guess we got more work to do than we thought.
Okay. So we have a little bit more work to do. So that's problematic. But I, put together this lovely... Feeling kind of sad that I did all this work.
You did a beautiful job.
Yeah, yeah. So, okay, I've got a bunch of, like, some basic graphics. This is just really just a host to start. But I didn't generate really any function bodies. I've got generate asteroids, move asteroids. Figured out a couple of ideas around move spaceship, but I really don't have anything here. And then if we go into game components class, nothing for players, nothing for the lasers, nothing for the asteroid. So it's just kind of the shell of an app. And if we compile the shell of an app, it doesn't compile because it's got 60 errors because there's nothing there. Okay, so not quite ready to go. Plus, we apparently not only have no artistic ability, well, you paint, though, and draw, okay. But we're going to go ahead and use Bing and click on this PWA over here, and we're going to generate some of the ship graphics. So I'm going to paste a prompt in that says, create a video game graphics for a small tops-down view, and I'll hit create. And this is going to use Dolly. That's not the picture. I don't know. You go and put a really creative prompt in, then it's like, here's a pixel hamster thinking. It's actually thinking right now, and it generates these spaceships. How awesome are these, right?
Pretty cool.
Now, the part that's great, yeah, go ahead and, yeah.
They're transparent.
They said transparent background. So I'm like, oh, wow. That totally looks like a transparent background. Let's go ahead and, doesn't that look exactly like you'd expect a transparent background? Let's bring that into paint.net. It's a wonderful application I got out of the store.
So it learned that transparent background means checkers.
Yeah. So I'm going to go and select the transparent background and then try to remove it to make the transparent background transparent. Which is about there.
Nice.
Awesome. Yeah. So then, maybe rather than transparent background, we say green screen background, right? Hamster thinking. An icon of a corgi. That's
not a hamster.
It's a corgi, apparently. Looking surprised. That's the pixel that makes it look surprised. No, hey, now we're cooking. Cool. So let's take one of these ships here. We'll go and grab that. I'll bring it back over here. We're going to go and do this, boop, and change the tolerance a little bit. Delete, delete. Hey, that's nice. Kind of nice. Cool. Then we're going to resize that to like 80 by 80, because pixel art. And then I'm going to go and save that, and we'll save it over here in ship.png. Cool? That's a long day of work right there. Cool. So now we've generated it. How did that happen, right?
Well,
what is Dolly?
Well, Dolly is a type of what we call foundation model. It's a large-scale model that has lots of great capabilities, and you can train large-scale models to do different tasks on top of the base foundational model. So they're called foundational because lots of specific tasks can be built on top of them. So for example, and they can be trained with different modalities of input. So Dolly is trained on a lot of images, but it's also trained on captions as well. You can have GPT-4, which actually the version of GPT-4 that OpenAI's got was trained on both text as well as image encodings. And what that foundational model can be do on top of that is generate text, generate images, do text-to-speech, a whole bunch of different tasks.
Is it a foundational model because it's a certain size or because someone decided and pointed at it and said, that's foundational?
It's typically because it's a certain size, so it's got enough ability inherent in it that you can have it do different types of tasks.
Cool.
Now, what is a model? A model is actually, with these types of models we're talking about, are deep neural networks. And deep neural networks consists of artificial neurons. You can see here a neural network with a bunch of artificial neurons, and then they've got connections between them. And it's actually the connections that define the architecture of a deep neural network. In this case, this is just a fully connected feed-forward neural network. All the inputs on the left feed through all the neurons all the way to the outputs. And then you can see there's two output neurons. Each one of those output neurons are going to generate some output. And if for a classification, for example, it might say, you know, cat or dog. For a next word prediction, one of the outputs might be one of the words, another one might be another word. It depends on how you're training the model to use the inputs and transform it into outputs. And really what they're trying to do is figure out some function. So this is some complex function based on these weights here, the parameters. Each one of these little formulas on those weights are a function over a weight times an input plus a bias. And so the number of those weights and biases on those connections is really how the size of these things are described.
But when they say neural, that's thinking neuron, which is thinking brain. Are we implying that this is the way our brains work? I mean, are we filling up a bunch of parameters as well?
If you take a look at it, our neurons are also connected with each other, and then they fire, certain synapses fire when you're thinking. And so this is very similar to this. Some of these will have higher weights than other ones, depending on the inputs and the way that the model's been trained. And so that's the way that it learns these functions. And if you take a look at the sizes of these things, they've gotten exponentially bigger over time. So BERT large, which was a few years ago, 345 million parameters considered huge at the time. GPT-2, 1.5 billion. GPT-3 from 3 years ago, 175 billion. Megatron Turing NLG, a model that Microsoft created, 530 billion parameters. GPT-4, we don't know how big that is.
But it's physically impossible to conceive of how big those numbers are.
They're
fantastic. People always love to go billion with a B. Like, that's going to make you understand how big that is. Like, oh, it's 1,000 million. That's a lot, right? And then it's not the number, though. It's the connections between them.
It's the connections on these
which
two.
Is an impossibly large number.
Like, the functions that these are calculating. I mean, if you think about the outputs of DALL-E, there's a neural network like that, and it's the outputs are generating an image based off of inputs, which are your prompt. And so imagine encoding all the ways you can generate images based off of a prompt that it understands cat and dog and spaceship and asteroid, and all of that is encoded in these neurons. Now, one of the misconceptions I think some people have is that when you train a model, you're just training one instance of it. But actually, the way that you train these large-scale models is with a few techniques that allow you to train it more quickly. One of the basic techniques is called data parallelism. And so you wonder why we have to build AI supercomputers. It's for the techniques that involve parallelism, because you can see here we've got three servers with three GPUs on them. We've loaded a model into it, and we're going to train that model by having it adjust the weights as it learns. And so we're going to feed into it each one of those GPUs different chunks of the large data set. And for each chunk, we're going to have them come up with their own idea of how close they're getting to the right answer, because we show it the answers and calculate what's called a loss function based off the answer. And after they each do their own local calculations, they share information with all the other GPUs, so they all get updated together.
So it's a big group project.
Yeah.
And they're all voting on
all,
the best,
exactly,
putting it together.
All averaging, actually, across them. And that's why you need these back-end InfiniBand networks that are really high bandwidth with low latency for them all to synchronize their state and then take another chunk and repeat. So that explains why you need these massive supercomputers. And then on the other side, once you train the model, you also need large numbers of GPUs, because you've got different users coming in. A serving plane figures out which GPU to map their prompt request into, and then other users come in. And the models, the implementation here is the GPUs are swapping in between different prompts. So if I typed something into ChatGPT and you typed something into ChatGPT, we might land on the same GPU, but our prompts are getting swapped in and out with each other.
So it's multiplexing these GPUs, just as if we were playing video games, two people on one video game, and different frames are being rendered, one that's appropriate for you, one that's appropriate for me, but they're sharing the GPU.
That's right. Exactly. And one of the things you see, like, why are these models getting bigger? Why are we going after bigger size models? Is that we see emergent behavior. They get more capable with more weights, more neurons. And you can see this is at around 100 billion parameters, you start to see jumps in capability across a whole bunch of tasks that you can see on here. This emergent behaviors you see between GPT-3.5 and GPT-4. GPT-3.5 is the blue bars, and these are a whole bunch of standardized tests. And GPT-3.5 did really great on a lot of natural language type tests, like English AP test, but it didn't do really well on biology and chemistry and physics and even law.
Wow, large language models, they're just like us.
But GPT-4, you can see, is the green bars, made huge jumps based off of the larger scale that it...
Is it smarter? Does it know more? Or is something emerging?
You know, that's a debate. It's certainly encoding more knowledge in those weights, but also the reasoning capabilities seem to have grown as well. Like, it can follow instructions. It knows how to do math, which GPT-3.5 and 3 did not know how to do very well, like those tests show. It understands images, even. It does reasoning. In fact, it understands code that generates images. And this is kind of a just mind-blowing emergent ability here. You can see here a prompt that went into a GPT-3 to draw a
unicorn yeah.
in a format called Tixi. And it produced this unicorn. So it had already, at that size, some idea of what a unicorn is and knew how to write a program to generate an image file.
There's a lot of questions there because it can't see that. It's generating markup. It's like asking it to generate it in SVG or LaTeX or something.
And like, how would it know, you know, based off of just learning, being trained on language, how to do this? GPT-4 when given the same prompt, generated this.
And so you would put that on your fridge and say, good job.
You might. But this is kind of another mind-blowing thing about GPT-4. It understands the image, and it also understands the code that it used to generate the image, because if you take the unicorn away and then say, hey, take that code and add the horn away, sorry, the horn, it knows how to look at the code and say, oh, here's the horn is really missing. Here's the code to add the horn back, and this is what it did when given that problem. So just kind of mind-blowing examples of emergent behavior.
That's crazy. I want to ask it to turn it into a narwhal and see what it comes up with. Let us switch back over to here and think about how we can apply that to some of the logic that I have not yet created on the back end. I've got a couple of things here. I've got games component class, which is mostly empty, frame streamer. So we have this idea that you're going to write the front end, and I'm going to have the back end, and the back end will use SignalR. So we want to make it a multiplayer game. It would be easy for us to just keep asking ChatGPT to generate asteroids on the client side, and we'd all go, hey, that's great. It'll be hard to get two languages talking to each other and
connected
to
and synchronized, yeah.
And connecting, right? So we're going to be shooting frames at of what's going on the screen, how are the asteroids moving. So the back end is going to be controlled by C#. And we're going to be using GitHub Copilot Chat, which is here inside of Visual Studio 2022, and then we'll switch to VS Code.
Which is part of Copilot X, which everybody here got access to, I think, yesterday.
Everybody should have access to that. And I love that it says, surprises are possible. So, like, let's just all set your expectations. This is all live, and we truly don't know what's going to work and what's not going to work. Now, I'm going to go to Games Components class right here, and I'm going to point out that Player, Bullet, and Asteroid are all completely empty. And I'm going to say Alt forward slash, which is a pretty obscure hotkey.
Yeah.
Alt forward slash. A. I.
I.
Ah! Well, good night, everybody.
I never realized that.
Yeah, it's genius, isn't it? You know who came up with that? ChatGPT. No, just kidding. Very, very nice gentleman in Redwood. Okay, so now I don't like watching Mark type, so I'm going to hit Windows H. Oh, and I'm going to start topping because now it's all messed up.
So I hit Windows H.
Yeah, I hit Windows H. Sorry. This is fine. Everything's fine. Fill in all the classes on this page, period. Make the properties lowercase and the parameters uppercase, period. Make all properties public. Voice typing functionality. Darn it. Try that again. Fill in all the classes on this page. Make all the properties lowercase and the parameters uppercase, period. Make all properties public. I did this like 19 times, but I didn't do it in a room with 98 people. Fill in all the classes on this page, period. Make the properties lowercase and the parameters uppercase, period. Make all properties public, period. Anyone who texts me or hangs out with me knows that I literally do this with email, with texting, and all that kind of stuff.
That's pretty good.
That looks like it did the bullet class.
Didn't do it all.
Did it do it all? I don't feel like it did it all. Mm. Ah, you know why? Look at this pink thing right here. What's that?
That is the context window, actually.
Right. So that context window, in that case there, is taking that this is the amount of information that it thought I was going to use, and then it applied that context, and that context was passed into Copilot. Yep. So in this case here, even though I said fill in all the classes, like I said, on this page, that might have been vague, it might have, you know, it might not have understood what I meant. I could go and try doing that prompt again. I could select everything and do that. I could change my scope based on cursor. These are all things that the Copilot team are trying to learn, because we programmers don't know how this should be used.
Yeah.
Like, should it care where your cursor is? Was that an expected behavior? Was that an unexpected behavior? We don't know. So let's see that now. Player. Okay, that just did player. Okay, cool. So they didn't do it. Let's try this. Help and do all this.
This is called prompt engineering.
Ah, much better. Okay. Now, of course, it's certainly not expecting to do that, but we'll go ahead and hit insert. And I want to point out something cool here. Notice how it, I was expecting it to go public class player, public class player, but it's smart enough
to insert it.
Because it's not just moving text around, it actually knows about things. And I'm going to hit then tab to accept. And I'm going to say here.
Well, make it so.
Make it so, okay. Cool, oops. Make it so.
You should say it though.
Yeah, I'll try it again.
In a Picard voice.
Make it so. Make it show. Let it go, make it snow. We won't really know.
Yeah.
Cool.
Ah, it does it.
Very nice. That's pretty cool. I didn't know that was going to work. Yeah. Thank you. Engage. That was more Professor X than
that was,
Oh! Yeah. What, it wrote tests! Not what I asked for, but appreciate it, though. That was awesome. That was pretty sweet, actually. Fill out this class. I have to, like, remember, okay, engage means do all the tests for me. Cool. Lowercase, did everything lowercase?
Yeah.
X and Y. Yeah, it looks reasonable.
Yeah.
All right, okay, probably fine. Ship.
Well, this is one of the... Actually, you should definitely code review what it produces.
Yeah. Well, like, because like the size and speed, it probably just made those numbers up. Like, I have no idea if those are the right numbers, but I can kind of look at them and think about this. But this is the thing, though. Is it reasonable for me to just assume? No. I need to know that this is.
Yeah.
I need to be a coder here. This is supposed to save me time typing. I want to be Iron Man, not Ultron.
Yeah. Well, I do want to be Ultron.
Well, that's your career goals. So. That's a really important thing. This is meant to augment people, but I still am going to spend time figuring that out and learning what's going on, and it's probably still not going to compile because I didn't actually do the actual stuff like moving asteroids and doing anything like that. So that's kind of challenging. So it fills in classes. We're still learning how those things are going to work. Now I move into games. I've got generate asteroids. I've got move asteroids. I've got to do that as well. Now I can not just hit Alt, but I can also right-click and say Ask Copilot right here. And that'll do that in line, or I can type in the chat. So I can move kind of organically around and do this however I want. Write this method. Oh, wow, it actually is like assuming, look, it popped out generate test. That's cool. Write this method. And this context on the right-hand side is continuing. So it's kind of learning, and it's also using the context of the currently open tabs. So there's generate asteroids. That's pretty cool. That's cool because it includes math. Move asteroids.
Yeah, do you understand anything?
I don't understand math, no. Make this one also. Sometimes I say please and the code is better.
It actually does, sweet talking, it actually does help.
It does.
Flattering it.
Yeah. Yeah, what must that be like?
What was that?
That's the part where you're supposed to be nicer to me on stage. Okay, and then bullet asteroids collision detection. This is where we're going to get into some really interesting stuff. Make generate this method also, please. Anyone else sing song they're typing? Just me. It's always funny when like the one person claps.
And then they're embarrassed.
Laugh or they smile and they say something like that. And with that, what I heard wasn't a chuckle. I heard, I think you're funny, Scott. That's the message that comes here. Because for every one of those, there's a tweet who's like, hey, the Hanselman think he's funny. This is not funny. All right, ship asteroids collision detection. That's interesting. I didn't ask it to do that. I asked it to do bullets asteroids collision detection. So that's kind of interesting. Do I care?
Wait, are you sure you were in the right one?
I was in, generate asteroids.
Yeah.
Came down here, move bullets. Here we go. We need to detect.
No, you were in the wrong one.
Oh, you're right. Yeah. But
it generated what?
Because of context, probably.
Yeah, because you were in.
Make this one. You sure? Let's find out.
Yeah.
See the gray, you see the pink context.
And actually,
right
if you'd said generate and then put the function name in, it would have probably generated that one. But you actually just put the prompt in the middle of it and said generate this.
Yeah. Now, this is a good example of where I'm not feeling super confident in this, because I'm kind of questioning these locks.
Yep.
And I'm questioning these for eaches. So, but, you know, we're on a deadline. Right. So the real question is this. Right. You know, so what we're thinking about here is this a good idea?
All right.
Did we miss anything here?
Well, you know, do we want scores to get updated?
I'm not sure. If we feel badly about this, like I'm noticing
one more time.
It didn't score.
Save that away just in case, and then try one more time.
Okay, let's go ahead and remove that. So we're going to, like, we don't trust that. That one feels kind of sus. So I'm going to go and say, generate this method. Yeah, that one was kind of mid, as the kids say.
Well, I expected to see something about explosions.
Ah, here you go, explosions.
Yeah,
so this is really interesting. Why did I ask it the same thing twice and it comes out different twice? Is this like when you just ask your friend and they're just,
it's actually,
one day they have a good day?
Let me talk a little bit about that.
Ah, good idea.
By talking about transformer models.
On your slides.
On my slides.
That are right there.
That are right there. There we go. All right, so these models are actually a type of deep neural network called transformer models, which is a type of model that was pioneered back in the BERT model that we showed earlier. The idea here is that there's two sides to the model. One is an encoder side and the other one's a decoder side. They take an input. The encoder side takes that input and transforms it into a very succinct semantic representation, which is called the hidden state of this model. And then it passes that encoded state that those layers generate to the decoder. And then the decoder takes that and transforms that hidden state, that intermediate state, into some other output format. So this might be taking in a prompt on the input side and generating an image on the output side, or taking in English on the input side and generating French on the output side. In the middle is some state that the model understands, hey, this is really the semantics of the prompt or the language. Now, these chat programs that we've been using are actually decoder-only models. They take in a prompt, and then they generate some output. In fact, they're using a next word prediction type of output. But before they actually can do this, we need to encode the input into a special format that the model can understand that also carries semantic information about the words that we're putting into the prompt. And this is a process called tokenization, or embedding, taking the characters and then breaking them up into tokens, which is, we're all familiar as programmers with tokenization, but here these are semantic tokens. So two words that are similar will be in this what's called an embedding space, close to each other, whereas words that have nothing to do with each other will be far apart. And that gives the model some idea of these words are related to each other, like king and queen are words that are close to each other and so related to each other. Where
if I ask it a question like, it's a beautiful day, let's go to the blank, where do you want to go?
I want a beautiful day, I want to go to the pool.
The beach. Okay, so which one's right?
Well, it depends, right? So what you're talking about is how these models do the prediction. And the way that these transformers, and this is really a transformative aspect of transformer models, is in 2017, a paper came out called Attention is All You Need. And this was a type of transformer model that uses something called a self-attention head. And it's called heads because there's multiple of them at a layer. And these self-attention heads take in all of the prompt at once, and then figure out each one of these heads, the relationships between these words based off of the tokenization. Actually, I wanted to show you the tokenization.
Yeah, let's do the tokenization. So you're on that one there.
Because we're doing is looking at words here, but
hit escape to get out of presenter.
Yep, but what we're looking at is the words, but we wanted to look at the tokens. And this is kind of cool. OpenAI's got this playground stuff that lets you play around with some of these concepts. Like this is a tokenizer example. So we can take some text and see how it breaks down. So if I do asteroids, you can see that that was two tokens, nine characters, and it broke the word apart like that.
Okay.
What's fascinating is if we say, let's build an asteroids game, this time.
Mm-hmm. Asteroids is one single token.
Yep. One single token, which is you know, just an example. And so what it's taking is each one of these tokens is what's being fed into that transformer.
Is that like compression?
It is like compression. And semantic compression is actually what it is. So on this multi-headed self-attention, like I said, it's taking in those tokens and then figuring out the relationships between the words. And some words, like this, what does this refer to? Well, this is referring to animal. And so the weight between this and animal that the attention head learns as it's being trained is going to be higher than its connection with anything else. And these are just made up weightings on these. And then based on that, it's going to send that in, that output into the next layers of that transformer model. And the way that you train these is that you mask the output. So you know how we just showed sending all of the prompt in? The way you train it is only give it parts of the prompt. And you generally do this word by showing it the next word. So for example, if we start with this, this animal didn't cross, and then we say the answer is the, because that's in the sample, we mask out the and then train it to pick the as the next word. And then we mask out street, but we train it to pick street as the next word, and so on. Now, the fascinating thing about this is that these models generate probabilistic outputs. Remember, I showed you multiple outputs? Well, GPT-4 and these models have multiple outputs, too, so they'll generate actually more than one next word prediction. And they put probabilities on them based on their training data. Like, you know what? I saw the word after these sequence of words, this animal didn't cross the, I saw street 80% of the time. But I saw other words, some other fraction of the time.
It's like a giant neural version of Family Feud.
That's right.
The guy's like, show me street. And then they vote on it, figure it out.
It's exactly like that. And so in the playground, you can actually see.
Ooh, hang on. I want to type. Does Mark Russinovich know what he's doing, or does he just Google really well with Bing?
Messed up my name. Thanks, Scott.
I don't know how to spell your name.
Yeah. All right, so I've got this playground to show me the temperature.
You can, like, make that go away. This thing. Close that.
Just move it.
You can, or close it, even.
All right.
It can also be closed. Okay. Does it tokenize now? Why did it boldface extremely? Why is extremely red? Why is it being so aggressive?
So here you can see the probability.
Voting on how awesome you are. You're 2% extremely. You're more of a well. Highly, we'll give it highly.
So you can see how the words come out of the model, and then as part of the model architecture, it's picking probabilistically one of the potential outputs based off of something awaiting called temperature.
Read the last sentence, please.
It is safe to say that he does indeed know what he's doing and does not have to rely on Google for his expertise.
And this is...
How does it know that, though?
How does it know that?
I don't know.
You are relying on Bing for your expertise.
That's right. I guess it did know.
It did know.
Yeah.
All right.
So this... what happened to my... temperature setting.
It's on the, I think you have to open the hamburger menu, don't you?
No?
I don't know.
It disappeared.
Well, is it in the dot, dot, dot thing?
No.
No? Then you're never going to see it again.
I don't know what happened to it. It's gone.
Yeah. So what's temperature?
All right. Temperature is just basically the chance that it's going to pick a non-high probability word. So you saw the list of words there that it was
there
saying.
It.
Yeah. Where, how'd you get it back?
I went control plus. Except
okay.
You've remapped caps lock to control.
Yeah.
As like a savage.
Be. Yeah. So here's the temperature, and we had it on temperature setting of 1, and that's kind of a good temperature. 0 means, like, always pick the highest probability. 2 means randomly pick one.
Yeah.
So you want to Try that again, see what it says.
Does Scott Hanselman know what he's doing, or does he rely on Mark Russinovich? Oh my God. The temperature is hot. Scott Hanselman actually possesses solid Hansive knowledge at Microsoft Spotlight.
So you can
event
see
and secret domain
when the temperature's really high, it really that so you can kind of map this to it, you know, Bing Chat, if you use that, it's got precise.
Why has it gone insane?
It's got
because of the temperature.
So Bing Chat's
I'm
got precise, balanced, and creative settings on it, and you can now probably figure out what it that those refer to temperature and also the length that it's instructed to generate output. Precise means go for a low temperature, close to zero. Always pick the highest probability. It's going to be less creative, but it's probably...
Oh, God.
What?
I put it at temperature zero, and it says I rely on you for advice and guidance.
It's very accurate when the temperature's low.
All right. We have to do real work, though, sir. All right. So back over here, when we're kind of yeeting these streams and frames around, we have no comments. So I don't actually know what any of this code does, and some of it's pretty interesting. So it's worth maybe asking what this does. So I'm going to right-click, say Ask Copilot, and I'm going to say Explain what this method does. Oh, I don't even have to sit there. I'll just click Explain.
I do this with my code all the time.
Really?
Yeah.
Because you don't, your hands are just flying. You don't know what's coming up.
Like, what did I just do?
Yeah, it's amazing. I'm a genius. So glad I don't have to rely on Hanselman for help, because Bing is available. This method is used to start streaming frames to multiple clients using SignalR. That's actually pretty amazing. Good. It's like having David Fowler in a chat, and it's just like, it's like legit telling me what's going on. It's a concurrent queue data structure. That's what it's doing. Send async. I find the explain stuff to be super interesting.
I like the generative,
if you're doing what we're doing, you're generating a bunch of stuff, that's fine. But the explanation is really powerful.
It is, and especially if it's code that you haven't looked at in a long time, or it's code that you've got a code base that other people have written the code and use like, and they didn't comment it because, like, I've noticed that you're not doing a very good job of commenting.
Mm-hmm. Let me try to fix that. Comment this code. I'm sorry, Dave. I can't do that. Oh wow! I totally did it. Oh, yeah. That's awesome.
That's pretty cool.
All right, sweet. Okay, cool.
So again, it's like doing a lot of work that. You know,
which is great if you bill by the comment.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's awesome. Let's see if it still compiles. Build succeeded. All right, sweet.
Oh, by the way, what tool are you using?
I'm using Zoomit.
Huh.
Yeah.
Who made that tool? That awesome, amazing, it's an incredible tool.
Copilot. Yeah. Zoomit is part of the sysinternal suite, and you can get it with Winget. Winget install sysinternals.
Yeah.
Yeah, Zoomit's great. Cool. So let's go ahead and hit F5 and run the application. Exception. So we just got an exception, not implemented exception, with a convenient link to the Copilot AI assistant. Let's find out why we have a no, not implemented exception. I just said...
Didn't you write that code?
Analyzed. Let me have my moment. This error happens because the code is throwing in a not implemented exception. This happens when the method is not implemented.
Ah.
Yeah. This might be happening because the developer has, in fact, not implemented the code. Right? Let's see how we could fix it. It could go either way. I don't really know.
Us?
To fix this, let's find out. Very excited.
The developer needs to implement the code.
Oh, my God. We should do that.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. Wow. This can be done by, and then
creating
it's
going to
tell me, that's very exciting. Right. Or just, you know, spitballing here.
Just delete that line.
Just run. Comment that line out.
Yeah.
So we're going to go ahead and do that. Yeah.
Fixed.
Does it compile? It's still going. Like, it's willing to. I appreciate that you're going, the developer, that's me.
Can check the
call stack and look for any other exceptions that might be contributing. So helpful.
Yeah.
So nice. Okay. I'm good, though. Oh, wow, and it links too. This is also cool. So this is important. Very briefly, mm-hmm. the idea that we're just kind of like throwing stuff at a chatbot, this is GitHub Copilot chat. It knows about code. It has questions about code. It has context that we're getting from different places. It can see perhaps now or the future call stacks, what the methods are, what libraries we're using with NuGets.
And actually, a lot of that gets put into the system prompt for it as well.
Right. So it's not just I say explain and we send it over there.
Yeah.
It's the context that makes the magic.
In fact, it put information about the exception in there. It put information about the code around it. It put in the system prompt, it puts the name of the file that you're working on, so it's got some idea of what language you're working on.
Exactly.
In fact, this is all about prompting, and that's, you know, that input that we talked about going into these models, that's the context. But because these models can follow instructions and because they can understand the words that are going in and follow hints from those words, we talk about system prompt, which is the stuff that an application will put in regardless of what the user's adding to it. And here's an example of a system prompt. So Bing Chat will say something like, you're a helpful AI assistant. It'll also have information about safety. And then the user, of course, types in their part of the prompt. And all of this gets put into that sequence of words that goes into the transformer architecture. And then what pops out are these next predictions. So given those system prompt plus user prompt, here are the next sequence of tokens that the model spit out, just like we saw in that previous example, it was completing a sentence. Now, one of the aspects of working with these large-scale language models is knowing how to prompt it effectively. And some of you might have seen this because there's like every day on Twitter I see this is the top 10 tips for prompting, and you hear about people getting paid lots of money for being prompt engineers. But there's a few basic hints here for prompting these models. If you just type in an instruction to it, that's called zero-shot prompting because you're not giving it any examples or not giving it hints for what you want. This is called few-shot prompting or one-shot prompting if you just had one example and you give it, hey, this is what I'm looking for. And that can help it understand the format and the context and what you're trying to do. So in this case, it might say positive. Here's another example where we're just asking it to complete word pairs. And if we just put a mountain equals without these other shots in the prompt, it would have no idea what we're asking about. But we give it some examples, and it says, oh, I know what you're trying to do. And so it's going to do a completion on this of Berg. So that's called few-shot prompting. Now, prompting like this is great for these large language models in cases where you, for example, want to give it a document, and then you can ask it, summarize this document. All of that goes into the prompt, and it's going to spit out something. But in some cases, that prompting isn't enough to give it a general information for a particular domain. And so what you want to do is fine-tune the model, which is basically taking that base foundational model and then augmenting it with information. Now, I'm going to talk a little bit about what that process is here called fine-tuning, but a little bit more about context window, because this is important to recognize, too, is that that window of text that we talked about is a fixed window. And as you continue to chat, for example, like Scott's doing, it's just adding more information to that prompt that goes in.
Well, that window is a sliding window, right?
It's a sliding window, right?
I don't know what day it is or what time it is or what your name is anymore, and that's because my window has been sliding.
Slid off, and so we lost the first parts here. And one of the attributes of these models is how big the prompt window is. So TextDaVinci 3, which is GPT-3, has 4,000 tokens as its input size, as its prompt size, which includes inputs and outputs. GPT-4 comes in two versions, one with 8K and one with 32K. And then other models have other different sizes. But going back to fine-tuning, what fine-tuning is taking that foundational model, giving the model more data, like, for example, health data, information about healthcare that might make a specialized version of this model that really understands health information, training it on that tiny augmented data, and then coming out with the target model.
All right. Well, I'm going to have to stop you because you've gone a little bit ahead, and we are going to
jump back into
VS Code. So what we're going to do is we're going to switch back here. Now, we've been doing the back end, and when we run the back end right now, what we have is just this, which is
Background,
and that's it. It's not doing anything, but the back end is like there and listening. Now, the homework that you were supposed to do was the front end. I'm going to switch over to Visual Studio Code for that. And within Visual Studio Code, we have the GitHub Copilot chat as a button within their kind of accordion menu here. So if I click on that, Copilot chat has a slightly different look, but it's the same kind of stuff. Yep. And you can see that I'm signed in, and it knows who I am myself. Okay, so the same exact codes. We have VS and VS Code opening the same exact project. I'm using VS to run it, and then the front end here. Now, under www.root.js, we've got our JavaScript stuff here. What we're going to do is we're going to have a JavaScript file to go and do the rendering, rendering.js. We have none of that written right now. It's literally, and that's why we're running
late. Sorry about that.
No, it's fine. You know, it's just covering up for your failings has become a... just kidding. So I'm going to go and I'm going to paste this in the interest of time. I'll show you the prompt, though, because we're not going to hide anything from you friends. I've just copy-pasted in a prompt rather than saying it. Add a SignalR connection to get a frame object, the one we saw with FrameStreamer, from the back end.
And this is kind of cool. It's because you're just going to take the output and
right.
create a class based on that output.
Yeah, this is going to be interesting because we haven't figured out how to make them talk to each other yet, right? So we're going to talk to a back end. We have to decide that it's going to be Game Hub. Right, so we're going to generate a little bit of JavaScript here. And this JavaScript looks like this. So we've got a SignalR connection. We want to note the URL is GameHub. We have an update frame and then a do some stuff. And then I'm going to note that this connection is a const. I'm going to make that a var. So there's kind of like, these are things you kind of have to know because, you know, you need that. And then with the game frame, in order to do some debugging, this frame object here, when we're updating the frames, I'm going to want to have a global. That way, if we need to debug this thing at some point, we're going to have that. And then I'm just going to hide that. So when the frame comes, hang on.
So that's in context.
So that's a great point. That's Copilot and Copilot chat.
Yeah.
So Copilot chat generated that. This is in line tab. It's like, oh, that's probably what Scott was going to do, which is pretty cool. And that was absolutely organic. It just figured it out, which is pretty cool. Now, to your point, we haven't decided on the agreement yet. There's nothing here that knows what a frame looks like. We haven't talked about what a frame looks like. But we can go back over here and run our application, okay? And we'll hit F12 tools here in Edge. And within this, we can see that SignalR connection started. And let me see here. We see normalizing game hub. And what I'm expecting to see is the output of the frame.
Join the game.
I got to join the game. You're right. Scott, play.
And then it's going to...
Scott, join the game. Do, 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 do. And I was expecting to see a frame pop in right here, and I did not because the frame... Oh, let me try to look down here at the bottom. Where's the console? Let's go and say frame here. Oh, did we call it game frame? What did we name that thing? Game frame, sorry.
Game
frame. There it is. Okay.
Uh-huh.
So that's what I needed to see. Okay. So the reason that this is interesting, this is the serialized version of what the back end
is
created,
good.
Right? So we're inside of the front end here. We're going to right-click on that and say copy object. This is kind of cool. So we're in Edge, right?
And
I say
we're
copy
have
object. Yeah.
Have it generate our front-end code based off of that encoding.
Because we are going to share those things. Yeah. So I'm going to hit like this. So that's kind of what a frame looks like.
Yep.
We got players, X and Y.
Angles.
Again, generated from the back-end code.
Yep.
Here's asteroids. I don't need that many asteroids. So we don't need that many examples, I guess. And then I know for a fact that I'm going to need
X and Y
for bullets, right? So we're going to need a couple of those.
And for explosions, too.
And for explosions. Yeah. Okay, let's do that. So this is showing you that you kind of have to know a little bit.
What you're doing, yeah.
Because you have to have an intent. And if you get stuck and you don't know what your goal is, you're going to be stuck. Okay, so I got bullets, I got explosions, I got one asteroid. Looks legit. Now, that is going to put that in the clipboard. So I'm hitting Control-A, Control-C, and that's now in the clipboard. So this is, I think, if we were to say, the most controversial prompt that we're going to do right now. And we've tried this a lot of different ways. We have this sample here that looks like the frame. And I think this is kind of interesting that it's this powerful, but I think it's also arguably programming.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So buckle up, kids.
It's programming in natural language, though.
It's going to get real.
Which means?
Implement the render logic in JavaScript. I will get the frames from the back end. It's a business description.
It is.
This is real. There might be multiple spaceships from multiple players, right? We're literally writing a user story. And within that, then we say, here's a frame object example. That frame object example we generated by running the actual code in the back end.
Yep. And this is an example of prompting it with an example.
Right. So then, the controversy is that correct and appropriate, right? Like, do you think that that's a reason? Is that easier than writing the code? It depends on the person, right?
Yep.
So let's see if it can handle that. The part that I don't like is I work so hard, and it's like, sure. It's just like, and then explains
yeah.
it. And then explains it. Oh my goodness. All right, well let's see, right? Okay. So I'm gonna take that chunk of code there. I can either copy it or insert it. I have trust issues. And it's not just because you're looming over me. No, it's fine. Who am I to say? So I'm just gonna paste that right here. And then I'm gonna go and say shift control P and format document, because I want that to look a certain way. And then this is the part of getting a prompt like this from something like Copilot Chat that is confusing, because it's like, now do I just stare at it for a while?
Does it look right?
I don't know. So we have two choices.
I've just simulated it in my head, and it looks good.
Dude, that would be awesome. Do you want to just run it?
Yeah,
not going to work, dude.
It's probably not.
No, like deeply not. Yeah. Okay. I think that's not even in the script. What are we doing, man? It's very likely this is not going to work. Oh, web server's already running. Start without debugging. Is it still going? Oh, I've still got it going back here. Start it.
All right, here we go. Drum roll.
There's no way it's going to work.
No way.
Where's it going? Where is it?
Where'd it go?
I don't know. Is it over here?
Ah.
Is that here? I don't believe it.
What's that?
I'm going to click on it and make it run up again. Okay, I'm going to work on that, and you're going to talk about fine-tuning.
So I was talking about fine-tuning, and the traditional way that you fine-tune is the way that I just showed you. You take that huge model that's already been pre-trained on a large body of data, and you start feeding it more documents. For example, health documents or legal documents or documents about your own enterprise domain, and then continue to train it until you produce this target model that now understands more deeply some specific type of data. This way of fine-tuning is actually very inefficient when it comes to serving.
Hey, boss.
Yeah.
Sorry to interrupt you. I know you're kind of doing a thing.
Yep.
Yeah. I forgot to call render frame.
Ah. Why did you do that? Oh, look at that. That is...
Sorry. All right, let's see if actually I can join the game.
Oh, look at that.
Yes.
That was it.
So it wasn't the AI. Well, maybe it was. The idea, remember when I was messing around in here doing frame?
Yeah, you added game
frame.
And
I did the game frame to make it easier to debug.
Yeah.
I did not actually do anything with the frame. So, yeah. Thanks. Sorry, if you want to keep going, or we need to deploy this to Azure.
Don't interrupt me again.
Yeah, don't interrupt you again. Yeah. Okay, you got about 3 minutes.
All right, 3 minutes. So fine-tuning, as I was saying, this version of fine-tuning is a little bit inefficient when it comes to serving time, because if you've got lots of customers that have fine-tuned models, you can't really leverage the foundational model because each one is going to be unique. And so on those GPUs that I showed earlier, you're taking those fine-tuned models, swapping the whole thing in and out. 175 billion parameters or more, you're having to swap in and out of the GPU. So Microsoft Research came up with this type of fine-tuning called low-rank adaptive fine-tuning, or LoRA fine-tuning. What they do here is they add some more parameters to the model, and then they just train on that small target data set with the foundational model and these additional neurons and weights to create this version of the large foundational model that has this extra information in it. You'll notice that the cool thing about this approach is that that foundational model, which is frozen and not updated, would be the same for every single version of the fine-tuned model. And so this is what allows us in Azure ML and Azure OpenAI to host many hundreds or thousands of fine-tuned models on top of the same GPU just by swapping in and out these fine-tuned models, which could just be a few hundred megabytes in size compared to 175 billion parameters in that GPT-3 case that I was talking about. So really efficient way to do it. And by the way, so just...
Oh, you got more?
Yeah.
No, do your thing.
All right, fine. And just one final thing, just the takeaway here is that the guidance for working with these things and prompting, start with zero shot, then few shot, and if that's not solving your business problem, then that's when you want to turn to fine tuning. All right, where are we with this?
So we've got...
so we're going to deploy this to Azure.
I've got Asteroids game, and I mean an Azure web app, and then I had to go and change some different settings here for sockets and stuff. And now it's on a website, on Azure website. So hit that website. I'm going to hide that URL so they don't see that, because they're going to go and join it, and then they're going to mess it all up. They always do that.
I saw the URL really fast.
All right, so.
Okay, so then join the name.
Hold on.
You got to control minus to make it a little bigger.
I know how to do this.
Do you?
Yes. Maybe. All right. Mark.
Some freaking person. Get him.
Yeah.
Who? Satya. Yeah.
Pew, 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 pew. Pew, 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 pew.
Ah.
Pew, pew. Pew, pew.
Ah, I got you.
All right. We did it. And they saw the URL. Oh, my God. Those people. What are you doing? Just through your slides.
All right. All right, well,
I cannot believe that worked.
I cannot either.
All right, I think we're at the glide. Yeah. We're at the glide slope now.
Yeah, so one of the also takeaways here is if you're going to build your own application that's using AI, including even these large language models, is to pick the right one for the job. So there's a misconception of, oh, GPT-4 is out, I should just use GPT-4 because it's so cool and powerful. The problem is that if you take a look at inferencing time, both in terms of the latency of inferencing, and then you take a look at the cost of the model, it's going to go up as it gets larger and larger context windows and more capable. And not every job needs the full, rich reasoning, science, and math capabilities of GPT-4. There's a lot of tasks that do great on GPT 3.5 or GPT-3 or even smaller models than that. And there's a bunch of open source models that do really great, and they actually run on a Raspberry Pi or an iPhone. And so you need to pick the right one for the job, optimizing for cost and latency that you need, as well as the size constraints that you might have.
And not everything needs a large language model. Like
that's
you
right.
might be prototyping, is this a hot dog or not a hot dog? And you're using GPT-4.
Yeah,
Do the prototyping and then figure out what smaller models. And then the example of Copilot Chat is a great one because it's a whole series of models, both local and in the cloud, and filters in between them. It's a whole pipeline.
That's right.
Of models.
There's multiple models. When you chat, there's filters to make sure that it's going to behave safely and correctly, and those are very small, efficient models.
Right, and then there's also in the context of Visual Studio, there's already with C# at least, there's Roslyn, there's IntelliSense, there's IntelliCode, there's inline as well as chat. There's also looking at comments and generating code. So there's many, many ways to be more productive.
And so that kind of brings us to the end. We actually did it, even though I came without homework. I think
I thought that was actually kind of cool.
Yeah.
So
I think some takeaways.
Takeaways.
Right? Models aren't going to replace developers.
Not yet.
Anytime soon.
No, I don't think so.
I don't think so.
But they are super fun, and we had to do a lot of debugging to figure out how to make this thing work correctly. But it did make it way faster than it would have if we had done it manually.
Yep,
yeah.
For sure.
So we hope you have a lot of fun building these kind of AI applications. But remember also the user interface matters. It's so important.
Well, this is, I think, something else. You know, this, hey, just drop the model in and you're good. No, you have to actually build a whole system around the model, including the user interface. Like, this is one of the cool things about GitHub Copilot team is that they're constantly working on the user interface, even for how they get appropriate context into the prompt. Mm-hmm. So one of the tips is open other pages of code that's relevant to what you're asking Copilot to do, because the Copilot team is going to take context from those other open pages in your editor and put that into the prompt that can help it.
All right. Well, thank you so much for hanging out with us and joining us for Scott and Mark Learn to Code. Yeah. Go forth and build stuff. Thank you.
Thanks.